about 1993, I've been studying the question of the sexual objectification of females. And as a psychologist, I've always been really interested in what are the kind of psychic consequences for girls and women of existing in a cultural milieu where the female body is just sort of always scrutinized, always used to sell things from tires to shoes, and what that sort of means in terms of the lifespan development of girls and women over time. How do they incorporate a kind of sexually objectified standard into their own psyches? And what must that mean? I got a phone call from the American Psychological Association in 2005. And they asked whether I might want to serve on a task force. The APA will sometimes name task forces if they perceive that there's some kind of potential mental health risk out there. The task force was on the sexualization of girls. And the concern had become, are we seeing an increasingly sexually objectifying treatment of younger and younger girls? And what can we do about that? Is it the case that this is a problem not only were we asked to document the extent of the problem, but also should we be concerned about girls' own mental health? We had really identified three sources of the sexualization of girls. One is a cultural source. It's one that we're all becoming increasingly aware of. And so we examined research on marketing and products to girls. Something that's really interesting is the proliferation of what I would call kind of downsized stores and downsized magazines. So for example, there's a store called The Limited. Suddenly there was a store called The Limited 2, where you took adult women's clothing and merely made the sizes smaller. So Abercrombie came out with Abercrombie Kids. And so the downsizing of adult style clothing for youth, and particularly for girls. So there are a lot more of those stores available for girls. And also the downsizing of adult, highly sexualized magazines. So now we have Cosmo Girl. Every one of the adult women's magazines has a girl version. Even a magazine like 17, for example, isn't read by 17-year-olds. No 17-year-old be caught dead reading 17. That's more like an 8 or 9-year-old magazine. We also identified an interpersonal source of sexualization. And so one of the things we were surprised to discover is how often parents and teachers and many of the people who are supposedly looking out for the best interest of children are encouraging a hypersexualized persona in young girls. We found an example of a study of girls in kindergarten who during dress-up play were often encouraged by the teachers to strut their stuff when they're dressing up and to really... In other words, I think the idea here is that femininity has come to be associated with sexiness. And if femininity a generation ago was associated with domesticity, I think Naomi Wolf in her book, The Beauty Myth, convinced me that a cultural shift sort of happened and we now associate sort of idealized femininity not with domesticity as much anymore, but with sexiness. And increasingly, we're applying that sexy standard to younger and younger girls.
Maddie's outfit of choice is gonna be Dolly Parton. It was an outfit that was made for me when I used to compete in pageants. So it makes it special for Maddie because she knows it was Mom's.
My mommy was also Dolly Parton when she was in pageants. This goes like that.
Does, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. When she wears the fake boobs and the fake butt, it's just like it's an added, you know, extra bonus. And it's really funny when she comes out on stage and everybody thinks it's hysterical because they all of a sudden realize that not only is she Dolly, she has the enhancements just like Dolly has.
Turn around, let me zip you up. And pull your booty down.
We tend to score really well with it all the way around from most everybody.
Let me see. Flip your hair. Is that what Dolly does? What else does Dolly do?
I love dressing up as Dolly.
Who are you?
Dolly.
Dolly who?
Dolly Parton.
Girls are not passive recipients of all these cultural messages. Girls are active agents. And I think we know from cognitive psychology, developmental cognitive psychology, that young boys and girls, once they know what their gender is, they're very motivated to be the best example of their gender. And if the examples of femininity around you are sort of a tarted up, kind of pornographized sexuality, then that's what you're psyched to be. So I've often told an anecdote of a time many summers ago when my family was living in Berlin for the summer, and my younger daughter, who was 7 years old at the time, we were on a streetcar and we were moving through the city, and we had come to a part of Berlin, it was Berlin after all, where prostitutes were soliciting openly. And I remember looking out the window, and my young daughter, 7 years old, was just really enchanted with these women. Some of them, of course, had long hair extensions, vinyl thigh-high boots. They were working the streets, and my daughter looked out the window and she said, "Oh, Mommy, look, they're so beautiful. They look just like Bratz dolls." And in fact, they did look like Bratz dolls. Coming back full circle to that cultural contribution to the sexualization of girls, for my daughter, a Bratz doll was a beautiful image of femininity. And here she saw, walking the streets of Berlin, exactly that exemplary kind of sexed up femininity. And to her, that was beautiful. And also, as a 7 year old at that point in life, she's very motivated to want to be that same kind of great femininity. So I'd say the third source of sexualization is girls themselves. When I first heard the song, I thought, "Girls Run the World." Oh, I was so excited and I couldn't wait. You know, super feminist mom, I said to my daughter, "Let's watch the video because this is going to be great." And of course, there are several things about the video that are interesting. Number one, it's really not about girls running the world. Of course, it's about adult women. And the way they run the world is by toying with men's sexual desire for them. But it's sort of this cross between Mad Max and All the Single Ladies. If you took those two things and put them together, you'd have this video. One of the things that I always feel like I have to battle in my classroom with young, even college-age women, when I was in college in the 80s, we called ourselves women. Now college students would not like to be called women. They'd rather be called girls. But one of the things that I try to talk to them about is this idea that kind of performative sexuality really is power. I think that a lot of young women have been sold a bill of goods when they believe that this voyeuristic kind of sexuality, where you pole dance for men, where you go wild on spring break and, you know, show your breasts. I suppose to choose to do that is an interesting decision to make. And yet I ask them, 20 years from now, when you're running for public office, are you going to be psyched that the home video of Girls Gone Wild features you? And then it sort of, I think, maybe doesn't feel quite as powerful. I think we have to ask the question of, you know, how did feminine sexuality move to a place where now it's about display? And I suppose, with, you know, the case of Anthony Weiner, male sexuality is increasingly about display as well. We're living in a world where the documentation of our life seems to be even more important than the living of it. And so the sending of images and the sharing of the portrayal of your sexuality, as opposed to the engagement in private with another person of your two sexualities, seems to be increasingly common. And I think, you know, I'm concerned with the sexualization of girls, but it seems as though we need to probably be concerned. You know, somebody needs to start doing some research, not only on the impact of the sexualization of girls on boys, but of this increasing emphasis on a kind of pornographized or voyeuristic or display-oriented sexuality for both genders. I've published a couple of op-eds on this work, and I remember I published an op-ed in the Denver Post. And, you know, you would think that if your op-ed is about, you know, what a troubling trend this is that we're sexualizing young girls, that you would only get positive feedback about that. But no, if you're making any kind of feminist statement, you're going to get some hate mail. And so a lot of the phone calls I got were from people who said that the reason for this, of course, was the feminist movement, and that there was something about women claiming their own sexuality, the pill enabling women to disconnect, you know, reproduction from their sexuality, that brought us to this place. I've always been suspicious of that argument. I recently, somebody had sent around on Facebook, even Rush Limbaugh came up with that it was feminist fault that Anthony Weiner texted his wiener. And it was something about how he had been so emasculated by feminist women that he felt he had to compensate by sending around these photographs.
I really believe when I say that it's the women that Weiner hung around with, that he worked with, the women influenced him growing up, that's why he's the way he is. And I think being surrounded by, raised by, in the same orb as, judged by, what have you, a bunch of feminist-oriented liberal women explains why it is that politicians need to keep cutting loose. It's no different than why Obama goes and grabs fast food every time he gets away from Michelle. Why can't we blame liberal women for what these politicians are doing? They have feminized politics to such a degree that men can't be men anymore. They all got to be out there and try to prove that they're Alan Alda or whoever is the definition of a real man. Michael Kinsley, I don't know.
When I think back to the Boston Women's Health Collective and sort of the Our Bodies, Ourselves movement for feminine sexuality, it seemed to me as though that movement was really about kind of women claiming their own pleasure, women trying to figure out how their sexual body worked, women sort of taking back a kind of patriarchal control over their sexuality. What I would argue, but this is kind of this is even more of a feminist argument, would be that this is really a backlash. This to me strikes me as a sort of backlash against a truly feminine controlled sexuality that says, well, no, the best kind of feminine sexuality is one that we see in a magazine, one that is made up and airbrushed and sanitized and deodorized and denuded. And so it's about you performing that sexuality for the culture and for us, not about you experiencing it in a firsthand way. And that goes back to my earlier argument about this idea of self-objectification, that what you give up when you internalize a third-person point of view on how you look and your sexuality is that first-person point of view. There's only so many cognitive resources that you have. So studies have actually shown that girls and young women who have this more self-objectified or self-sexualized view of themselves perform more poorly on concurrent cognitive tasks. We did a study where we had college students try on swimwear alone in a dressing room, the control condition, they were trying on sweaters. The cover story was a kind of consumer decision-making study. And there you are alone in a dressing room. If you're female and you're standing in a swimsuit as opposed to a sweater, you don't do as well on a math test that we say, oh, you know, while you're getting used to this garment in the dressing room, could you help us with this study for the math department? And so women perform more poorly on the math test in swimsuits than in sweaters, and no difference for men. Other studies have shown that girls with this more self-sexualized standard throw a softball less effectively. I know that sounds odd. The argument there, I think, is that the classic throwing like a girl phenomenon is not really about having two X chromosomes so much as it is about being preoccupied with the sense of how the body looks as the body's attempting to perform a physical or mental task. We've shown that girls with a more self-objectified view on themselves are less likely to use proper birth control during sex to make poor sexual decisions, to be more likely to give, but much less likely to get oral sex. And so putting themselves at greater risk in terms of sexual decision making. This phenomenon is not insignificant in the mental and even physical health of girls and young women themselves. I remember seeing Little Miss Sunshine, and the last scene of Little Miss Sunshine really summed it up for me. So you see the Abigail Breslin character, and I don't know if you remember in the movie, she wants to participate in this child beauty pageant, and her grandfather is sort of training her. And her grandfather teaches her for her talent. She's going to perform Super Freak and do a sort of sexy dance. And so what I think is so beautiful about that movie is that in the final scene, it's like we see that somehow the movie points out the hypocrisy of a culture where we say it's perfectly fine to dress our daughters up in false eyelashes, hair extensions, makeup, have them sashay before judges. But as soon as they do the Super Freak dance, we say, oh no, that's not okay. Have we seen the hypocrisy? You know, Abercrombie is in some ways right to say the culture wants their 6 and 7 year old daughters to wear strap-on breasts for bikini swimsuits. Somehow, I think we have yet to figure out exactly where to draw this line. Everybody gets so offended. And yet, you sort of look at the steps that were taken to lead up to that bikini, and it's a lot like the steps of the movie Little Miss Sunshine. And I thought that that movie was such a forceful cultural commentary of our times right now. Everybody thought it was just sort of cute and quirky, but I wept in the theater. I thought, this is a really deep movie. It's saying something really important about a profound hypocrisy that we have in our culture about girls and their sexuality and their attractiveness. There's this movement, you know, it's a very new movement. It's called positive psychology. And a lot of really great research and a lot of good work is coming out and, you know, looking at the positive emotions of human experience. Psychologists have, you know, ever since Freud looked at the underbelly. And I feel as though I've been doing negative psychology for a really long time. One of the things that I'm moving toward right now is to try to figure out some more positive psychology to combat some of these issues. And here's an example. I want girls to laugh about their boobs and their periods. And I think that if we can stop sanitizing, let's say, you know, menstrual marketing, and turn these kinds of corporeal bodily events that are about our emerging sexuality into sources of mirth and good humor and, you know, maybe even gratitude, then I think some good things could come of that. So I have some ideas about the next phase of my research. I get a sabbatical soon, and I want to start thinking about some programming right around menarche, right around when girls are starting to get their first periods. Some programming around the physical body, the corporeal, creaturely body, that's about levity and good humor and about a kind of becoming full of oneself. And I'm hoping that that's a new place that I can go, and I'm hoping that works.